Good evening, everyone. Delighted to have such a lively and knowledgeable crowd for our chicken workshop. Having been part of the awards team granting the Derek Cooper Award this year to a rather shocking investigation into the welfare state of chicken, too much of our chicken today, this year, still, after all these many years, the question, amongst others, is why? Why is there still so much wrong with our chicken? And it's a question that was being both asked and answered by the man to whom we dedicate tonight's event. Gareth Jones was invited to speak, to head up the event here, in honour of his long-standing campaign for better chicken. Many of you will have had the great pleasure to meet him and the revelatory experience of speaking to him. I'm very, very sorry that he passed away with his work really not completed earlier this summer. But we are delighted to have his wife, we're honoured to have his wife Joy Davis here to tell us a little bit more about his work. This was Gareth, and I'm happy that I knew him. I just hope that his work will come to fruition. Hattie will be very ably running the event tonight and introducing the speakers. I just couldn't resist, in the light of our forthcoming tasting, quoting or showing you this article from the Daily Mail earlier this year, and it was looking at the perfect roast chicken, and the answer was, it's in the bag. And why was the answer in the bag? Because the cooperative had taken the move to be the first supermarket, and others may follow, I don't know whether Sainsbury's will, we have people here who can tell us, to say that, well, the only way of protecting the poor British public who really don't understand anything about hygiene and welfare standards is to give them chicken in bags they don't need to open, so there is no danger of contamination, no danger of Campylobacter poisoning. And interestingly, the range of chickens tasted, they were all about 1.5 kilos in weight, ready to go in the oven, so eviscerated, plucked, seasoned, possibly glazed with a brown glaze. They ranged in price from £3.99 to a maximum of £7, 1.5 kilos. I don't know whether that surprises you, or do you think that that's the norm? Certainly not the norm of the chickens we've purchased tonight. But enough from me, and I will hand over to Patty to tell us a lot more about chicken in Britain today. Thank you. Delighted.
It's fantastic there are so many people here. And about 10 years ago, I wrote a book called Planet Chicken, which started out as a quest to eat my way around the world, discovering the world's cuisines through eating chicken. And then I went into a broiler farm, and the journey took a dark turn, which was trying to discover. The subtitle which I suggested for the book was The Fair, the Foul, and the Finger-Licking Filthy. And I wasn't allowed. But this event is to look at chicken. It's our most popular meat. 750 million chickens killed in Britain a year. It's everywhere, from the dirty food to the clean food, clean eating. It's a ubiquitous default choice, and yet do we really know how it's produced and what the difference is between, I'm sorry to call it bog standard, but I'll call it BS, and proper free range. So this is about, this event is a discussion about that, and also a celebration of good chicken, because unless we celebrate it and appreciate it and enjoy it, do we care? So you probably know Catherine Phipps, who we're very lucky this year, Year of the Chicken, that one of the best cookbooks that's come out this year happens to be on chicken, and it's Catherine's book, which she's got somewhere. but it's got 200 recipes, chicken, over 200 recipes devoted to one glorious bird. So I'm going to start off by asking Catherine about some details about cooking chicken and how you tell a good chicken from a less good chicken. And our other speaker is Peter Gregg from Piper's Farm, who I interviewed when I was writing Planet Chicken. Peter will be introduced by a film, but suffice it to say, he's a shy, and Henry, his wife, is here too. They both run Piper's, which is a group of family farms which bothers at every stage. So what does bothering at every stage mean? And we're going to find that out. And then we're going to have five chickens which will trot their way around the tables at intervals during the evening. So but we're going to start with Catherine. Can you tell us how you got into chicken? What's your root in?
I grew up with it. My parents did the 1970s thing, had a big small holding in a very, very rural part of North Lincolnshire. And I was in charge of the chickens. So I was in charge of the chickens that laid eggs, but also the roosters that were foraging around. And because my parents strongly believed in us understanding how things worked and not being squeamish, of course, I was taught that when a layer had stopped laying, when a rooster had outlived its usefulness, and also we did the whole spring chicken thing as well.
Can you explain that, what a spring chicken is?
Okay, so every year we would allow some eggs to be fertilised, and they would be incubated, and the females would go on to be egg layers, and the males would be reared for a few months, and then they would end up being, well, most of them ended up in the freezer, actually. So we'd have a supply of them throughout the rest of the year. So I was brought up very strongly to respect the food that we were eating, but also to treat it in a very holistic way. So the reason I wanted to do a book on chicken was because we've got so used to treating it as something that's portioned up and shrink-wrapped, and I just think that it's a lot more than the sum of its parts, really. If you take a whole bird, there's so much more you can do with it, and I wanted to write something that reflected that.
And some of your discoveries for that, can you talk about the economics of buying a whole bird and compared to buying, say, breasts?
Well, I think everyone in this room probably knows that you can go to your butcher's or supermarket and you can buy three or four chicken breasts for the price of a decent, what I would consider to be a decent free-range or organic bird. Yeah, and you have whatever the meal, I mean, if you choose to buy chicken breasts in the first place, which I guess quite a lot of food writers wouldn't necessarily. You cook them, that's it, the meal's finished. You buy a whole bird. What I would normally do, whether I'm poaching or roasting a bird, is the breasts would be treated separately and used in a completely different way. They're almost a byproduct of cooking the whole bird, because it's my least favourite part. So you roast a bird, and so you've got the roast meal, you've got the stock you'll make from the carcass, you've got the skin if you decide to poach it, and this is something that I quite often do because you can break it down in a better way, is I will take off most of the skin, leave it around the legs and the thighs and maybe underneath. Take out all the fat, because one of the good things about a chicken is that the fat is on the surface or is collected in certain parts of the chicken, so you can remove it. It's not marbled all the way through. So you've got the skin you can treat in one way, because you can fry it, you can use it as a garnish, you can make gribines with it. You've got the fat.
What's a gribine?
Grabeens, and as someone said to me the other day in Manchester, they call them gribbiness. It's chicken rendered down. It's a byproduct of creating schmaltz, which is rendered chicken fat, which has as good a flavour as goose or duck fat, really. So the byproduct is you render it down very, very slowly, you slice it up very, very thinly, and you get lovely little crisp strips or nuggets of chicken skin, which you can use. I mean, I use it in the same way as I would use very crisp lard on some bacon. And if you want to add a smoky flavour to it, you can add smoked salt, or you can actually smoke the skin before you actually make the grabeens, which is something I do quite often. Well, you can cold smoke them, but normally I'll just do it in a wok. So you line a wok with foil, you put in whichever aromatics you want, and you can use sawdust or chippings of wood, or you can do the tea method, which is tea, a bit of rice, and a bit of sugar. And then put them on a grill, seal the whole thing, and put on a very low heat for 15 or 20 minutes. That's probably all it would take. And you can keep taking it further. One of the things that you can do with the grabeens when they're like that is whisk them up into a powder, and the seasoning you get from that, it's just you can add instant chicken to anything, really. And again, that's something you can also do with the stock. One of the things I found you could do with the stock is that you reduce it down to get a really, really rich stock, and then you can dehydrate it into something that's like a chicken version of fruit leather, really. It goes completely dark and transparent. And if you dehydrated it enough, which you can do in a very, very low oven, you can whiz that up into a powder as well, and you've got instant stock.
Have you done those things with different kinds of chicken? Because I want to ask you about, maybe from a cook's point of view, the difference between different kinds of chicken.
From a cook's point of view, I mean, when I was writing this book, I did try a whole range of different chickens. And what I found was that the better quality chicken, the better result, the end result is with everything from the skin right through to the bone. Because this is a thing, if you spend a little bit more money on, and to be honest, I would say that a lot of what we consider to be a free range, you know, kind of entry level free range chicken, I can't actually tell the difference in taste much from a really bog spot BS chicken. I honestly think that if you've got a chicken that has been fed an interesting diet and all the things that you go to talk to Peter about, basically, you do notice the difference.
What's the that age chicken? I mean, when you what sort of chicken would you recommend? Got a particular kind?
No, I haven't actually. I rely on my butcher these days. I lived in Norfolk for a while until quite recently, and one of the first things I did when I moved there was try all the different farm gate chickens, all the chickens available at the farmer's market, to find the chicken that I really liked, which I did do, and it turned out that it was a farmer's wife raising chickens for hen money, pin money, whatever you want to call it, which is the kind of chickens we bought once my parents stopped rearing them when I was a child. There's always kind of a local retired agricultural labourer or farmer's wife who wants to do that in small flocks of about 250 to 300 birds. Now I rely on my butcher, and he gets three different kinds of free-range ones. The first one is okay, the other two are great. They're older, they're bigger, they're coming in at kind of about 2.5 to 2.8 kilos. Mm. They have a lot of fat in them.
When you buy them, what do you look for the fat?
I look for kind of that lovely creaminess you get, a slight blue veining. Always look at the hocks as well. because there's a lot of free-range birds that I see with really bad hock burns on them. At least I assume they're hock burns.
Do you notice that, Peter, when you're looking in shops?
Definitely. The hocks is a very good indication of the life that the chickens had. Yeah, it's a very good indicator. Mm.
Do people know what they look like, the hock burns?
Do you explain that?
You're probably better explaining that than me, but it's, yeah.
The thing that with a chicken, when they sit down, they take the weight off their feet by bending their knee, and so the hock is that knee joint that then will be sitting on the bedding that they're living on. So if you take the norm, which is in an industrial chicken in a shed where they are living on a bed of litter that is absorbing all of the feces and urine that are excreted by an enormous population in a very confined space, they are effectively living on an absorbent sponge that's saturated with urea. And that's potent stuff, and it will burn exposed flesh, and that's any real reddening of the hock, or in extreme case you can actually see it blackened. That's hock burn, and it just tells you that poor chicken has spent its life. And I mean, yeah, there are lots of degrees to which that might affect the bird, but it's a surefire way of telling you quite a lot about the life it's had.
I just want to ask you about the bones of better chicken and the smell of chicken is wafting towards us. So after that, we will taste our first chickens. And then I think we've actually got some chicken bones here to illustrate a point. But when you are making a stock, for example, what do you use in your stock, and what's the difference between what matters in terms of bones and type of chicken?
Right. Well, actually, one of the important things for me when I'm making stock is not just bones. I like to have quite a lot of skin and meat in them as well. And any good butcher will give you chicken backs, which will have quite a lot of meat attached. But it depends how careful the butcher is, actually. If it's a day when one of the junior staff's doing them, then you get a lot more meat on, which is good. You can make a really good chicken stock if it's a decent chicken with just chicken. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. In fact, I had a discussion with somebody the other day who really strongly believed that any vegetables you add to a chicken stock will just absorb chickenness and not give any flavour to the actual stock, which I don't think is true. It's not my experience at all, but I haven't really done it since we had the discussion. But
you also, Catherine's written a very good book about pressure cookers. So does that help? Are you a sort of fast and hard, or?
Yes, definitely I am. Because what happens as soon as you start pressure cooking something is that intensity of heat, it goes up to about 119, 120 degrees Celsius. The caramelization kicks in. So a lot of people, if they want a really, really good brown chicken stock, will roast the bones or the carcasses first. You don't have to if you're using a pressure cooker, because it will just happen automatically while you're doing it. And you can do a really good, light chicken stock in about 20 minutes, and a much more intense one within about half an hour to 40 minutes.
That's in the pressure cooker.
You should know that. Again, you can add anything to that, and anything you add, so carrots, onions, whatever, they will start to caramelise as well. because that's another thing. I think people often put onion skins into a chicken stock for colour. Mm. You don't actually need to do that if you do it in a pressure cooker, but it won't do any harm if you do.
So it's a reaction happening.
It's like an, excuse my pronunciation, Maillard reaction, reaction. Mm. It's happening inside a pot instead of on a grill or in the oven. So you just don't need to brown. Mm.
Does it get cloudy, Catherine? Because I was always told you stop really low and slow to heat it in here, yeah. So the fat doesn't kind of emulsify into the stock.
I find that it's not cloudy. It's not that absolutely crystal clear stock. Yeah. But as soon as you clarify it, it will be. So you can clarify it the normal egg way, or you can do the kind of filtering in the freezer way as well, and you'll end up with a really good clear stock. It's darker. It's a darker stock. You can do it for less time and get a much lighter stock if you wanted to as well. And the other thing you can do is you can do it twice. So sometimes, with all the meat on the carcass and everything, I'll do one stock in the pressure cooker and get quite a light one, and then I'll do a longer one for or the other way around. You can get, with good bones, with good kind of raw materials, you can do that. You'll get the intensity and flavour that way.
And Peter, can you say, do you make chicken stock for pipers? Mm. What do you think about bones? What do you use? And what's the difference between good bones and brittle bones?
I think bones are a really important indicator of the life an animal's had. So whether it's our beef, our pork, our lamb, our chicken bones, the same principles apply. If you grow an animal slowly enough, one of the benefits of letting it reach natural maturity is they develop proper bones, hard bones that have real bone marrow. And then, equally importantly, I think, for the stock, it's all those tendons and gristles which attach the bones together. So the Achilles tendon, I mean, particularly with any of the four-legged animals, but certainly the same applies to chicken too, those tendons running up through the drumstick, that tendon that really attaches the leg joint to the socket joint at the pelvis, a mature animal has got real oomph about that tendon. And that's what you're melting out when you create the stock. It's melting the collagens. Now, we hang all our carcasses, the beef for a month, the pigs for 3 weeks, the lambs for 3 weeks, the chickens for somewhere between a week and 12 days. But during that time, there's a microbial breakdown of some of those collagens. So all of the connective tissues that are binding together the muscle fibers and which are holding the bone structure together, they're the things which are starting to break down and tenderize during the hanging process. But it's all those component parts that are delivering real value to the stock. And your stock will thicken as long as there's real collagen in there.
It will always set, won't it? If you're using that kind of chicken, it will always set. Whether it's, I mean, I find that even with a quite light stock, because of the amount of collagen in the chicken, you'll still get a set. Sometimes, you know, not even in the fridge.
Absolutely.
And that's something you notice with a roast chicken as well, with a really good roast chicken. If you put liquid in the bottom of the pan, you will get that jelly around the base of it, which I don't think you get in one of the, how long is it now, 6 weeks? They're shaving it off even more, aren't they?
Yeah, come back a bit. But yeah. I would hope, I didn't see the pan our chickens are being cooked in now, but I would hope in the bottom under the carcass will just be a thick, rich, brown sauce. There isn't a pan full of liquid because there is no excess moisture, and the muscles have got a mature texture, the bones, the cartilages, the gristles are proper, you know, they've got real oomph. And oomph translates into thick, rich building blocks for cooking in the bottom of the pan.
Proper umami. It's like Marmite.
Absolutely.
Marmite.
Absolutely. And our job as farmers should be to deliver that material, the raw material, to cooks, really.
Joy, would you like to talk about your
revenge? Yes. Gareth is passionate about chicken and spent half of his life working with it. He tried to bring poulet noir into England in the 80s, and it was just too early. I actually remember him coming to IPC and tasting it, and it was just extraordinary. However, he then set about this whole study of pure breed chicken, which you find in France, and he pretty much grew up in the kitchen in France, with friends cooking and on the market. And to him, roast chicken was the ultimate. It was the dish above anything else. Roast chicken with watercress, which is the traditional accompaniment in France. Very simple, perfect marriage. And the chicken needs to be sticky, all the things that you talked about. The skin needs to have a good texture, so it crisps in the oven. There needs to be an age of the chicken. Interestingly, the free-range chicken is in the UK is 56 days. In France, it has to be 84. Mm-hmm. That is the requirement. So all of a sudden, you can see the broiler chicken you talked about is now 30 days. So Gareth coined the term eggs on legs for those chickens, because he said you might as well eat an egg and enjoy it, rather than, you know, waste the egg for 30 days and eat the chicken. And interestingly, when he went to Poulet de Brest, which he did every year for the celebrations, the confrérie, Georges Blanc, who is the president at the moment, was talking about the British chicken that he bought from the rotisserie. And he said, oh, I know the one that you put on the table, shake the bag, and it carves itself. So Gareth was absolutely passionate about the V-shaped breast, the long leg, the strong bones, and we have two bones here. This is a French chicken, pure breed, nearer to the wild, nearer to a guinea fowl. A good proportion of brown meat to white, rather than the other way around, which is like a rugby ball chicken. So completely straight, very hard. This, shockingly, is an organic British chicken. Okay, you can pass this round. A Ross bird, so exactly the same as the 32 dayer, probably 56 days, but fed so that it grows quickly, too much breast, can't hold its own weight, and bends. And this is an organic £13 from a supermarket, as opposed to €8, 84 days, fabulous texture, flavour, and everything else. And the supermarkets in France are full of them. You know, you have to look for the value chicken. There are three or four or five different producers producing poulet fermier, and they're all €7 and €8. You know, and French supermarkets always have something on special offer. Why 22 miles across the water do we have this for £13 with a bent leg that shakes itself in a bag?
I think that question is when, as we keep discussing and we start talking around the floor, I think that is the question.
Well, you need to look at feed, you need to look at length of time.
You also need to look at, I mean, if you have a free-range chicken and you have a intensive feed system, so the birds are overfed, they're not going to go outside and scratch for worms, and because they're overfed, they need to be kept lean and mean and keen. Mm. So
do you think that they need to be literally fed at our time, like timing, so you get this amount that it's weighed and it's measured?
Well, I mean, Gareth said that they're just overfed. They're taking the intensive system of feeding the regime and just putting in, allowing the bird access to the outside. But they hurt, they're kind of creatures that stay together in the warm. They're not going to go outside if there's a nice juicy bin of GMO soya, which is used. They're not going to go out and find a worm. Whereas the French system, they do. They have access to outside, and they go outside because they need to go and find some food. Because they're not being stuffed with a grain diet, which, you know, puts on weight quickly.
Is a French chicken foraging all its own food?
No, they will be fed. But the stocking densities, I mean, this is something that people will know more, but the stocking densities are much less. And they're simply not overfed. So not sitting sort of lying back thinking, I'm stuffed, I'm just going to lie down now. I need to go and get something to eat because I'm hungry, you know? And that's what you need to build the muscle. They need to work. I mean, like we all do. Otherwise, we have flabby muscles and no texture and soft bones. This is shocking. And Gareth couldn't believe it, you know? And this was why he wanted to get a pure breed chicken. And he challenged the supermarkets over and over again on his blog. And you can all read about it on Gareth Jones Food because it's still there, last of the independents. And nobody would take the challenge. And he said it is possible to produce a quality chicken in the UK. So that was just part of, you know, what he was doing. But it says it all. And you can feel these and touch them and look at them. They're there.
Bring in the birds to a lot of these issues, such as stocking density. This first one is a Labelle Anglais, which is grown in East Anglia. I think it's 76 days old. Favoured by Jamie and others. And we're also going to bring in, I'm afraid, straight away, a BS.
In the 28 years of the life of Piper's Farm, one of the most challenging things we have tackled is the chicken breeding programme. So we knew that we wanted to produce chickens that behaved like that. We knew that we wanted to have our own breeding flock laying the eggs from which we hatched the chicks. But after a generation of industrialising chicken production in this country, there really weren't very many purebred strains left, or enough genetic diversity of those strains. So we worked really hard with Light Sussex, with Cornish Game, with Indian Runners. But breeding programs require a good mix of birds that do what they're supposed to do. So the females have got to be really fit and active and fertile, and the males likewise have got to do their job. And to cut a long story short, we did eventually give up and we went to France, where they have hundreds of breeds that the local small-scale family farmers take into the local markets and lay them on a table. So we bring back those genetics from France as eggs or day-old chicks to start our new breeding flocks. So that's French genetics. But, you know, there was a very good reason why that was the place to go.
Peter, Sally was just asking a question about the importance of purebreds and why it is important.
Okay, I think this helps to illustrate our perspective on this. All of our beef is purebred Red Ruby, which is the native Exmoor beef breed. Exmoor is in the distance. that's what has been bred up there for generations, and we only have purebred Red Ruby. We only feed them mother's milk and grass. Brilliant. With chickens, it is this issue about getting consistency of supply. We don't have a local native purebred chicken. So by going to France, we were really working with what I think a lot of the people in France would work with a purebred, but I think there probably is also a healthy mix of two traditional slow-growing strains hybridized. So our lambs, for example, are a mix of a North of England Mule and a Suffolk. Really old-fashioned traditional genetics that suit this country, but it's a combination. These chickens, likewise, are a combination of bloodlines of French chicken, but they are properly utilising the right slow-growing genetics. Our pigs are purebred saddleback mothers with a Welsh boar. Two traditional slow-growing strains. So as long as the genetics are of the right type, a first cross, I think, delivers the characteristics that we want anyway.
And what breeds are these that you're using? Or is it a trade secret?
Up to a point, but I think that you could go to France and walk around the markets and pick up any number of breeds. And
if they're French, they're better, basically.
They are. Piper's Farm was started because I went to the Paris show in 1980. Well, this is one of the components. I went to the Paris show in 1987, and the food hall was 70 or 80% of the enormous showground. And the farmers spent 3 hours eating lunch, sitting under a big banner from the region they came from, so passionate and proud about what they'd grown, whether it was food or wine, drinking it and enjoying it. That's the French culture, and you could go and find an area where somebody's growing chickens and you could come back with amazing genetics. There's lots of it over there.
How long do your chickens, how long do they reach maturity?
We grow the pullets for 12 weeks, 11 or 12, and the cockerels for 12 or 13. So basically, we're growing our chickens for 12 weeks. Mm-hmm. And then we're hanging them.
Right. So what sort of weight would they get to?
They would average, long-legged, we average about 2.5 kilos. So that's, I'm wrong about that. Long-legged, we average 3 kilos, but oven-ready, the average is 2.5. So a cockerel might be about 3 kilos oven ready, and a pullet would be about 2 kilos oven ready, somewhere.
Right.
But our background was starting where, well, actually, I just want to hand that round, if I may. I'm sorry, it's not edible. It's not nearly as good as the other things that have been handed round. But in a way, it's an important part of the history of Piper's Farm, because this was my great-grandfather's first shop, number 58 Atlantic Road in Brixton. He opened his first shop in 1870. John Sainsbury opened his first shop in 1869, about half a mile away from each other. For decades, they had a gentleman's agreement that they would not open a shop in the same street. I think, shamefully, it was my great-grandfather who sort of broke the decency of that agreement.
And we'd never look back.
Anyway, he ended up with about 230 shops. But the point of that picture, every time I look at it, it demonstrates for us what the French food culture with chickens is all about. You can go to a market in any French town and see chickens laid out on a table, head on, feet on, guts in. That's how we mature our chickens once they're dead.
And going from that extreme, you can also get really good proper rotisserie chickens in France as well, which you can't here. I mean, even amongst a big group of food writers, I'm sure there's the odd occasion when you just want to buy a rotisserie chicken, and you go into any supermarket and you can't get even a free range one.
Yeah.
They're all just bog standard chicken. I don't understand it. I don't understand why that happens.
Question. I'm just wondering what the guild here can actually do. A lot of what we're hearing is fascinating and I'm really enjoying it. And we're talking about the brilliant food culture that we have in France. But unfortunately we're in the UK and we know that the average shopper is not prepared to pay premium. But what can the my question is, what can the guilds do about that? How can we enable shoppers to be prepared to buy better, to trade up, not to focus just on rest? You know, I think within this room, lots of people have blogs, lots of people that have articles. What can we do as a group to enable that whole food culture to change?
Well, I think we'll all give an opinion and everyone else will have an opinion. I think it's about knowing the detail of what makes a difference. And, for example, appreciating all the bird, which is why we started talking about skin and bones and fat, because it's about appreciating what those are and how to enjoy them and eating the whole chicken. And about knowing who the farmer is.
When you put two chickens side by side and you roast them, and that's all you do, you can add your butter and lemon and whatever, but really there's nowhere for the flavour or the texture of the chicken to hide when you roast it. It's so apparent with the bog standard, but I mean, you must notice just from this taste that we've done so far, the difference is massive. I mean, that one, the pappy kind of, as you said, cotton wool texture, there's no decent texture. I mean, there's barely a chicken flavour there at all. And but the fact is, people, probably a lot of people, don't even roast a chicken in a traditional way anymore because they're just putting so much on it. There's millions of recipes on the internet for things you can do to enhance a roast chicken. You can glaze it, you can stuff it with this, you can inject it with this. There's a million and one things you can do to get other flavours into the chicken. And the reason you're doing that is because you're not concentrating on the chicken flavour. You're concentrating on all of the other flavours, and that roast chicken has become a flavour carrier. So until you get people away from doing that and actually concentrating on the flavour of the chicken, I don't think anything really is going to substantially change.
So maybe it's about writing less. Less is more. And concentrating on the purity. And that goes down to sort of the detail of cooking as well. That how to cook something simply. And just starting off with a recipe with three ingredients.
There's a million and one recipes again for ways to make a chicken breast interesting. And there's so many people that if they have a roast or a grill or anything, they just want a solid piece of chicken breast and that's it. But they know it's going to be dry if it's cooked properly. They know that it's not going to have the flavour. So they're boring holes in it, they're stuffing it with cream cheese, they're wrapping it in bacon, they're doing absolutely everything they can do to get flavour into that chicken breast, which I just think is really a bit of a pointless exercise. Butterfly it out, marinate it and grill it, and then you've got a lovely moist piece of well-flavoured meat. Don't kind of look for ways for adding value where there isn't really value to add. You're not adding value to chicken flavour, you're just putting other flavours there.
Peter, you're a retailer. Who is buying better chicken?
Well, I think in answer to your question, I feel it's quite relevant. When my dad had to join that family business in 1952 because his brother died suddenly, And as a farmer, or my mum and dad as farmers, they had to move close enough to London, so he commuted to London and ran that business. The first thing he did was realise that chicken was eaten once a month as a treat.
Yeah.
And in the States, they were just developing the process of industrialising chickens. So he went across to the States and he brought it back to this country. This is 1953. When I was very small, I grew up with Dad's early stages of industrial chickens in this country. So it was a shed, 7,000 chickens in and windows down one side. Now I can hardly remember the time that those windows were left clear. I do remember they were then painted red. Then they disappeared altogether, and before I was, way before I was 10, the next house had 14,000 chickens in it. And then as a teenager, he developed a shed with 40,000 chickens in it. So the site before I left home first time round had 2 7,000 bird houses, a 14 and a 38 or 40,000 bird house. When Dad brought them across in 53, those chickens took about 75 days to grow to 4 pounds in weight. When I left home, that was down to about 48, and as was said earlier, that is now down to about 31, 32. And I think this is, I'm sorry if it's slightly circuitous, but this is a direct answer to your question. The food culture in this country has been swept along by the supermarket shelves, being full of a product where the decision making about how that commodity grows is made by people who originally developed it. So these are enormous global companies based in the States. The people who make the decisions in those head offices are constantly working out how to make that commodity cheaper, because all of the main retailers in this country compete on price. And so, if from the head office they are offered the opportunity of genetics which will grow the chicken faster, they grab it. If they're offered a growth promoting food supplement, they grab it. And if they then are told, if we grow these chickens in sheds of 100,000 instead of 50,000, we can cut the unit cost by another half of 1%, do it. Mm-hmm. And then, because my brother took over this unit, which when in 1987 Henry and I decided to start Piper's Farm, that broiler unit was only producing 500,000 chickens a year. The processing station told my brother to forget it. It wasn't even worth their while getting out of bed to operate with such a small entity. So now, commercial mainstream chicken units will routinely have houses of 100,000 birds. And my dad not only grew them in 1953, he developed a poultry processing plant. And he, at the end, was processing 25,000 chickens a week. He had a lot of growers around Kent growing for him, 25,000 birds a week. In Devon, we have a factory processing mainstream chickens of all varieties, mainstream, free range, organic. They process, or they have the capacity to process, over 200,000 birds a day. Mm-hmm. Now, nobody, and this, I had this discussion with my dad before he died, and he said, when I started this process in this country, I never ever expected that nobody would challenge the exponential growth. The people who are making those decisions are simply interested in driving down unit costs. Nobody is interested in the implications. And of course, by far the biggest implication, quite apart from what it tastes like, is that those systems are only sustainable with the use of absolutely eye-watering quantities of antibiotics. Mm-hmm. And Henry and I started Piper's Farm because we had young children, and we were shocked to think that as farmers, we would feed chicken to our children that had already been treated with antibiotics, which is one of humankind's greatest gifts. And yet the abuse of it to produce industrial pigs and poultry is frankly wrong.
90% of all farm antibiotics go to pigs and poultry.
Can I add something to this from a food writer's point of view? Sorry, Jenny, do you want to say?
Well, I was going to ask, this model of this enormous, implacable industrialised system, and are there cultures around the world that have got a different, talk about France, but Germany, is this all around the world that's happening? Or are there countries that are going, no, this is a bad thing to do, we need to clamp down antibiotics? Are there any bits of light?
The point really was the answer, and I'm sorry it's been so long-winded, but I felt the bit so far irrelevant to the precise answer to your question. What could the Food Writers Guild do? How do you stop this juggernaut? And the point is, this juggernaut is global. The reason these companies have so much power, it's like the people who wield the power of GM technology, they are enormous global businesses. So it's very hard, I would suggest, to write a blog or even a really heavyweight book or an article in this country and expect to turn that juggernaut around.
What you have described is the global banking system that puts the money into doing it.
You got it, but there's nothing about eating quality or nutritional value or health or any of that. But where I think we should go back to is to a culture such as France, where it is people who learn to appreciate the value, A, proper value, and B, the reasons that they're getting value, rather than, I guess, the chicken my dad started producing has now become utterly valueless. So many people buy a chicken without any appreciation of its value, might only use half of it, and throw the other half away.
I don't know if you're a dairy farmer as well, but unfortunately the same with milk.
Yeah.
Milk is, in fact, almost at the moment.
And how many people
works.
Buy cream and throw half
of
that
dairy
away,
farmers
or
are just,
yogurt?
They just can't continue.
Food writers have always been talking about it. When I was researching my book, I went through all the old classics. So of course I always turned to Jane Grigson and Elizabeth David and everyone else. And I had a 1954 edition of one of Elizabeth David's books. I think it was Italian Food. And I was reading it and she was talking about how during the Second World War, there was a dearth of roasting chickens, young chickens that could be roasted and still be tender and lovely and everything else. And she was actually saying, I'm sure a lot of you have got out of the habit of having these wonderful chickens at your disposal. So if you've forgotten how to roast them, this is how you go about it, and this is what you can do with it. And then there was a little asterisk and a footnote on that page a year later saying that this is, of course, before the advent of all the mass market chickens that had suddenly started coming in. So I think it was a difference between 1953 and 1954 when they suddenly became aware. Yes. And Jane Grigson literally... a few years later is spelling it out in French charcuterie. If you're going to make this chicken dish, do not buy a frozen chicken or an oven-ready chicken from the supermarket. You need a proper boiling fowl that's spent years grubbing around the farmyard and will have proper flavour and proper, as everything you were saying, proper collagen, because otherwise you just wasting your time, really.
So it's about valuing, as Gareth's blog says, independence, last of the independents. If you don't have a large mainstream good chicken farming culture, which is different to France, and France, I've read that it's 30% of the market is proper free range, as opposed to 5%, which is even called free range here, let alone being free range. So you you have to look for the independents who are doing it well.
And unless you know a good independent, it becomes very difficult to do certain things. So for example, if you want to do a proper traditional chicken soup, chicken broth, you know, like the typical Jewish penicillin type thing, all the recipes that I put into my book said, if you're going to do this, you need to use a regular chicken plus a couple of chicken backs or some wings, or cook it in a light stock, because it's impossible to get a boiling fowl anymore of the quality you want. You can go somewhere and probably get an old battery farm broiler, which really isn't what you want. There's absolutely no market for decent free-range or organic boiling anymore, because they all go for pet food or chicken nuggets or whatever.
One of my questions is, as to what we can do about it, is there enough difference between good free-range and just on the label free-range? And I wonder if, Peter, you could talk a bit about the difference. How do you make your chickens range? And what is the difference between that and one that's...
I think this is, again, it comes back to this issue about culture and how you change it. I just wanted to make one point sort of allied to that, that I think we find exciting. The people who buy chicken from us don't necessarily have lots of money, but the one thing that I would say is common to all of them is they are smart enough to have worked out how to get value for money. I don't believe anybody would ever buy a whole chicken from us and not then make a risotto and then not make a soup. And so the cost proportion is down to, you know, pence. So, I think,
Piper, would you also say the people who buy from us, buy chicken particularly from us, but anything, people who actually care about what they're eating. And I guess that is something that, you know, the Guild needs to be talking to those people who are saying, I care about what I'm eating, what I'm feeding my family, and so on. I think, to be honest, I think it's been really interesting in this discussion how shocked you guys have been about what we've been talking about, which is, we know because we've done it, we've farmed Marks and Spencers. So we know what we have done, and it was that that made us say, we're going to start Piper's Farm. I think it's really interesting, the reaction that you guys have had. But I think the people who are coming to us are not wealthy people, definitely not. But they're the guys who have said, more important to me than anything is my health, the health of my family, and, you know, I'm coming to you for that reason. And I think perhaps it's that angle that you guys need to encourage. I think it's really interesting, Hattie, that you said the Wellcome Trust have bought the co-op farms, because I think that's another really interesting thing. The guy who's heading up the Wellcome Trust at the moment is saying the biggest risk to human health at the moment is the amount of antibiotic that is being fed to livestock. Yeah. And that is the biggest, you know, he's done Ebola, he's done SARS, he's done AIDS, he's done all sorts, but he said that's the biggest threat at the moment to human health. That, I think, is the message that you guys could put out. And what is really interesting is I think the medics are now thinking about it. They've logged that this is the problem. We've been talking about it for 28 years, but finally they've woken up to it.
But medics versus, you know, these super corporations from the States, I mean...
But we're all, our health is important to all of us, and I think all of us are well aware the NHS is in chaos, and I think that is something that people would listen to.
We're getting to the point where TTIP is about to happen, where corporations can sue nation states for passing legislation that they're not happy with. So, you know, I feel really pessimistic about it, actually. I just, you know...
But I think in answer to your question, Hattie, about is there sufficient difference in the labelling on a mainstream retailing outlet shelf, it's very, very hard to create real difference. If those chickens are basically on a very similar system, there really isn't a substantive enough difference, and they are being processed in the same way, that's a problem. This probably heralds the requirement to go back to a genuine local food culture, or more of a local food culture, where the people buying the food can apply those sorts of criteria that do matter, and our customers are testament to that. But out there are many, a growing number of people who say, actually, I do start to really care about the food I'm eating, but to have real credibility, to be able to trust in the source of the food, there needs to be this local food culture where there is real accountability. It isn't simply a label. That is, marketing departments have had field days with nice pictures and good words and a veneer, because a supermarket customer takes, am I right, something less than 3 seconds to make a purchasing decision. Well, in that time, if you're busy and you're in a hurry, it doesn't take the marketing department much effort to sway customers to buy all sorts of things. But actually, that is no substitute for a genuine food culture that is locally based. There really is integrity and there really is accountability. And frankly, we as farmers have a very important part to play in that. And I think the point you make about milk is very good, but we lost the grip on milk when the Milk Marketing Board went.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we were split up as an industry. They chopped us up and picked us off one by one. As an industry, we need to, like the French, cooperate. We need to get a real understanding, a passion for meeting proper market requirement. And we've got to empower ourselves. We can't simply be individuals picked off by, you know, pharmaceutical salesmen or in, you know, feed salesmen and those people who, it's their interest to sell all these ingredients, to sell the genetics of fast-growing animals, to tell farmers, of course, that's the way you make more profit. Absolute rubbish, because the farmers' margins, the price has been driven down relentlessly. The more inputs he puts in, his costs are going here, the price is going there. The only way to survive is to get bigger and bigger. Actually, connect with your market, get real value conveyed the whole way to the moment somebody sticks it in their mouth. They understand value. They understand they want more of it because it's better for them. They know they're sustaining the local countryside, the local rural community. There are millions of consumers out there who would get that.
But the fact is that most people don't care, and they want cheap food.
Could I ask a question about the use of antibiotics? Could someone briefly enlighten us? Is that a message that could be used more prominently on labelling or packaging to use some form of scare? I mean, I hate to call it scare tactics, but Is there an opportunity to educate about use of antibiotics?
I mean, the complexity about this is that people will say that antibiotics for humans are different from the ones used for farm animals.
And it's
very difficult to prove. This is about antibiotic resistance.
Right.
It's very difficult to prove that one is leading into the other. Lots of people are themselves convinced that this is happening, and antibiotic resistance has risen at the same time as the increased use, routine use of antibiotics in intensively farmed livestock. So about 90% of antibiotics are used in pigs and chickens.
Preventatively, as opposed to actually treating something.
Mm. Yeah.
Preventing them from getting antibiotics within their groups,
because they can't live.
Because if they're living so intensively, if they don't use these antibiotics preventatively, it's just
they don't live long enough to develop a proper immune system anyway.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah. Also, and I asked all the farmers about do you use antibiotics, Peter? No.
Well, one of the greatest natural bacteria sites is ultraviolet light. Mm. What do industrial systems do? They exclude ultraviolet light at all costs. It's a stupid idea. But
they exclude it because of cost.
Why do they exclude it?
Well, why do they exclude
well,
it?
If you're if you're trying to grow a pig or a chicken, let's focus on them because, as you say, probably 90% of industrial farm antibiotics.
Actually, Peter, I'm just going to interrupt. I'm sorry. Because we've only got 50 minutes left. We have one more chicken to go. And I really want to show everybody your legs.
Wow.
I am delighted to be talking about that is a leg and a half.
I want my wife to hear that somebody said my legs are worth it.
Is having a man too, she should be worried. This is not a complaint, of course it isn't, because I'm intrigued by the green stuff. Presumably this is the gallbladder.
Absolutely.
Sat next to the chicken. So as a consumer, I mean, I'm not worried because I'm a chef, but as a consumer, people might be worried about that. Do you want to say something briefly about that?
Yeah.
And then I'm going to say something else.
Perfect. I think the gallbladder staining, you would say, is one of the sort of offshoots of maturing a chicken guts in. So we're hanging it guts in, uneviscerated, long-legged, for this chicken's been hung for 12 days. So you will get that bit of staining, and you'll get a bit of staining on the liver. And so you want to be careful to cut that off. And I guess it's good just to take the little bit off if it's stained a piece of the breast. I'm glad the legs look like that, and also I think you'd find you would really struggle to just cut through the bones of our chicken, the breastbone of that chicken. You really would struggle to cut through. We would have to saw it at the farm, but that is an indication that's bone with real marrow in it. Very briefly, so antibiotics, the main food poisoning bacteria are E. coli, Salmonella, Campylobacter. Have I left one out there? Anyway, those are the three main ones. You could not design a more perfect environment for them to thrive than an industrial chicken or pig shed. Why are they dark? They're dark because if you let sunlight in, and this is why Dad painted the windows red, if sunlight goes into a shed where you have an awful lot of birds with nothing much else to do and a ray of sunlight, they are naturally cannibalistic. They would just eat any bird that had, or they start pecking it. And if it stayed in that ray of sunlight, they would just go on pecking it to death. So of course, a lot of these industrial systems, they cut the beaks off. Industrial pigs these days all have their tails cut, teeth cut. And, you know, one of the nonsenses to me of mainstream pig production is they don't castrate them because they then have these testosterone-fueled animals crammed in the environment being fed. It's like shutting a load of teenage boys in a room with Red Bull and vodka and probably Haribo's. I promise you, that's the sort of cocktail of food those animals have been given because the genetics are there to grow. They are fed a cocktail to make them grow like hell. But they are lethal killing machines then because they would eat each other. So you dim the lights, you put them virtually in the dark. And as discussed earlier, you make them, you just about give them enough room and enough energy to stand up, walk to a feeder, push their way to a feeder, stuff themselves full of food, and flop down again. The bacteria think that is absolute paradise. And so, as was said earlier, no natural immunity in those animals, maximum perfection for the food poisoning bacteria environment. How do you sustain it? You have to feed antibiotics to suppress the bacteria. The worst thing you could then do is take those birds with the bacterial challenge in the guts into a huge factory rip the guts out and wash the whole environment, because the one other thing bacteria love is moisture. So I don't know if I've said enough, probably
so,
too much.
So there we have chicken in a bag.
One really stupid question. It's a question I never managed to get to the bottom of when I was researching everything. Chicken we have to cook to a certain temperature and all the rest of it. Why is it okay to cook chicken livers pink so the blood runs still?
Well, they say that it's not for Campylobacter.
Do they?
That one of the biggest sources is chicken liver parfait.
Is it really?
Along with the St. Valentine's Day massacre, when people who don't cook chicken very often cook them.
Because it always worries me, because often you cook them and you want to cook them for a really short period of time.
Yeah. What do you think?
I'm afraid, and this comes back to the Daily Mail chicken in a bag, as I understand it, the reason that is the perfect chicken is because that raw chicken is not out of that container between the factory and 75 degrees in your oven. Now that is a shocking, shocking indictment of our industry, that we are producing food that is fundamentally unsafe until it is cooked to 75 degrees. We should produce every bit of the chicken, including the liver, that you could pick, cook as pink as you want. Not we're producing food which has to be cooked to make it safe. And that is why that bag, and it's shocking, that is the new revelation about food safety, is you keep the Campylobacter in the bag until they're killed. Oh boy, shocking. We should not be growing Campylobacter in perfect environments. And the onus should definitely not be on the consumer to deal with the problem. That's absolutely... What are we doing as an industry? It's shocking.
But do we not think that here is the UK, the membership of the RSPB, enormous, we love animals.
PCA is huge.
We love food. If people, if a child looks at a different system, it's a no-brainer. So I guess when you're asking how do you influence people, do you take it back subtly, in whatever way you can, saying this is an animal?
I think chicken is very sterile, isn't it? It's almost the bulk of most consumers in the country almost
don't.
It's an
animal.
And also you can generalise about who the consumer is. You can easily say everybody cares about money, of course. And some people have to care a lot more than others.
Yeah, yeah.
But in the end, it is also a priority about not saying we can't challenge this because of the money issue. That actually, to say there are people who, if they knew a bit more, would change.
I was going to say that as a child, as a 10-year-old child, I was taken on the arm white to a farm, toward the back of the kitchen. It was a scratchy farm. And I went through it, I came out, I burst into tears. And the family was mortified, you know, but my, and that was it, my only thought. Free range, because I just sort of saw that actually that this was a, there was a consequence.
Yeah. What you're saying too is a lot should come down to schools and from a young age, you know,
but schools,
a lot of my thoughts are now.
But schools are so
schools
are so desperate to be inclusive and not exclude anyone because of financials or religion or anything else that you can't actually talk about these things because you're saying, tell your parents to buy a more expensive chicken. By the way, don't buy halal either. Because it's almost impossible to get free range or organic halal.
The government's spending hideous amounts of money on obesity and on problems with welfare and everything else. So if they put the money into training or teaching at a young age, then 15 years' time, they might actually save a hell of a lot of money.
But why can I give us a reason to be cheerful? I went to an event where at Highgrove, and they have people, the Prince of Wales can bring people, people come there to look at good farming. And the people who've been there the week before was the CEO of Yum Brands, who owned KFC. And they had gone there because they were worried because the millennials, who I forget the exact population, but basically people 25 sort of age, were not eating, are going off their kind of fast food. And so they're getting more interested in organic, free range, whether it's good free range or what. But there seems to be some sort of shift in people. Yeah. It's not cool to eat KFC.
I agree, actually. My brother is now a 21-year-old, still in his teens, isn't he? He just eats crap, basically. He eats BS and KFC. Well, he did about 4 months ago. And suddenly, he watched a programme on TV. I think it might have been run by a man whose initials are J-O. And now, he insists, he says to my mother, you must cook with this, and she said, well, I have been doing for years, but you only buy food. And suddenly his mindset, after years and years of being about eating, it just changed. And so I agree with you, something is shifting, but unfortunately I don't think it's shifting in a mass, in big enough circles that we are trying to
produce. But what was a free range egg? That was my one thought, as a, in the way that, you know, it was the norm to battery egg, and that was sort of in many ways. Free range eggs are very dominant, much more available, you know, sandwiches are free, you know. I used to be, I went to John Gundry in Marylebone years ago and he had free range eggs, you know. That's like radical, you know, from a farm, that's like really radical about 20 years ago. And that's the norm, isn't it? That'd be the new norm.
Why do McDonald's have all their eggs free range but not the chicken? Why do so many supermarkets put free range eggs in everything but not free range chicken? It's just...
Yeah, if you buy any kind of pre-packaged chicken dish, it's never using, you know, you
like the rotisserie.
Yeah, the other rotisserie or a chicken kip or something like that. And I also wonder about the, you know, there's so many, you were talking before about the kind of rise of dirty, you know, the dirty food. There's so many kind of chicken shops and they all say that they're using free range. But I mean, how can we tell how free range their free range is?
Yeah.
But you can only do that by asking. I mean, rather than by making a consumer. When I worked at River Cottage during Hugh's chicken campaign, and there it was, it's just about educating people enough so they can't pretend they don't know. Mm-hmm. So then you're making a choice, but you're making an informed choice. And one of our largest problems with that was really in this country, unlike France or some other country. There is still this resistance that people think of high quality food as for posh people, for other people, for middle class people. And there's a lot of resistance where people say, well, I can't afford to spend. Our big thing was, you know, then they had two chickens for £5. So how can you see that as a living animal if that's what you're trying to pay for it, when everybody along the way is making a profit? Well, not the problem then was people just.
That the whole thing in this country about sheep food policy has destroyed the industry, and he believed that good food is the right of everyone, and can be the right of everyone if people are taught and people know about taste. You have to teach people what good food tastes like, because otherwise you don't have a hope in hell. Because if they think BS chicken is chicken, that's chicken. They've never tasted anything else. So I mean, I remember when I was food writing that were tomatoes packaged grown for flavour. What else do you grow a tomato for? It's not for flavour, but no, not for the supermarkets, because it's grown for shape. Grown for colour and it's grown to not go on.
And for price.
And it's for price and it's to go in the packet. And if six fit in the packet, that's all you need. I mean, these were people I was talking to who were cutting the tails off kippers to go in the box. Not let's then make a big box. No, it's just chop off the tail. So, sorry to go on that on again, but Italy is also doing amazing stuff too. In France, they have something called a Canne de Goût. which goes around all the schools and teaches children about taste.
And how they publish the menu for the school.
Oh, don't care.
The three-course menu in the primary school.
So, it doesn't have to be an elitist business. And I think that whole thing in this country that if you're poor, you eat shit. And if you haven't got, if you're not poor, you're middle class and you're frugal. I mean, it's time to stop to actually educate people.
As you mentioned, this whole thing about price and poverty and accessibility, and that's always the kind of quoted, cited counterpoint, isn't it, to quality, accessibility, affordability by the masses. What we'd like to do is chart, particularly our chef Christopher here, is chart your reactions to the chickens, and could we also have a guideline? We've not discussed the price of those chickens, have we? And I'm sure everybody would love to know. So
yeah, our chickens would retail, the ones we've had in here today would retail at about £11.50, £12 maybe. They're about 1.8 kilos. They are, we have a nationwide online business. And, you know, obviously there are, we supply all sorts of chicken carcasses if people really want value out of us. I think we sell chicken carcasses at about 50p each or something at 25p each. I just wanted to give, sorry, because you might want to go through other prices. I wanted to make one other point to pick up where Hattie's keen for good news stuff. Henry and I have been now into three schools in Exeter. It's right to be specific about this, really run-down parts of Exeter. And they've invited us in to teach the children about chickens. So we've gone in with dead chickens, head on, feet on, and just swung it around the classroom, and there's, oh my God. But then we've shown them the giblets, the gizzard, the neck, the heart, the liver, and just laid it all out and showed them how the gizzard works with the bits of grit in there and the whole corn and all of that. And one of the most striking anecdotes, I think, is in Windstream Primary School, which is in Burnt House Lane in Exeter, it is as challenged as you can get. We had four classes of 30 kids for 40 minutes each, I think, through a morning. In the first class, there was the group of the cool lads, always the biggest lads, who were not even switched on, not engaged. And when we said, here, have a bit of soup, which we'd made from chicken carcasses, and it had quite a rich flavour. No chance. Have a bit of chicken fillet. No. One lad in particular eventually caved into peer pressure. Oh, go on. Okay, I'll have a little bit. And of course then mopped up everybody. So he was a big lad. He'd not had any breakfast, obviously. His teacher came back into the class at the end of the fourth lesson at 1 o'clock and said, I've just seen a miracle. That boy, who is so disruptive, has been totally focused and engaged the whole morning. He's been just a totally different child, simply because he put proper food in his body at 9 o'clock in the morning. But there was a really excited uptake. Children who'd never seen a whole chicken, when we said, have some soup, many of them said, what is soup? So that's, I hope, exciting. It's hopeful. That's where it has to start from. And like you say, in 15 years' time, hopefully we have a generation of people in this country.
And what sort of chicken are they serving for the school dinners? Depends on
the school. The fact is, it is mainstream. It's bog standard. There is no other option. The school food in the South West Peninsula is supplied by Scorse Foods. It's mainstream. It's industrial, because that's what's out there. But at least if young children start to understand this, what was it called in France? Something
Academy de Goût.
Academy de Goût. Why shouldn't we do the same thing? I know that it's a bit weird in this country, whereas in France it's obvious. But that is the way to start, surely.
There's extensive research that my wife Mary has written about a lot of the influence on good food at the beginning of the day, breakfast particularly, on disruptivity in the classroom. Same thing in prisons, for heaven's sake, bringing the whole level of antagonism down with food.
If education is the big gap, which I would personally agree as well, the government have just pulled all funding for doing GCSEs and potentially A-level food technology, so there's already a gap, there's going to be a bigger gap.
They just put Home Ecs back.
They're in consultation at the moment is about you guys are powerful as writers to be able to change people's opinion to take part in that consultation period. I personally
which ends on Thursday.
Yeah, it's a risky thing to come.
And they're also taking away the free school meals in primary schools, having just introduced them.
No, I agree. That's the biggest, one of the things which needs to be challenged and get into schools. If it's not going to be done through GCSEs, then you have to find other ways of doing it.
How's it coming out?
Well, I think it's A-level.
It's A-level.
It's still key.
Yeah, okay.
It's key.
You've got to watch all the individual chickens. Yeah. I mean, it's not, you don't have to take a vote for anything like that.
No. Shall I tell you the cost?
Let's go through that.
So, Poulet de Bresse. I went to the ginger pig, and there was the bird with its legs on and its guts in, and they chopped it, and it took a sort of good 6 minutes to watch this, and it's sold with the legs and the neck actually, which apparently is very good for stock. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so but it is £17.50 a kilo. That is ginger pig.
Yeah.
And the one which I'm afraid I ordered, which they'd sold, was their 100-day-old chicken, which is £10 a kilo. So then, what's the La Boulangerie?
The La Boulangerie was £16 each, and I think, what was the price per bird?
It's about £30.
£30 per bird. Yeah. The La Boulangerie from Wyndham Poultry, and picked by Barra today, was £16 each, which I thought was extremely reasonable. But yours is a farm gate price, Peter, is it? You put a middleman to
No, that's a retail price. We have a shop in Exeter. Can walk in and pay that, or there's a nationwide online shop. I think it's important that we could be the seabed of the way chicken could be produced. I mean, it's about local food cultures. Online sales mean that people could use us as their local farmer, even if they're in Edinburgh or London. But in reality, we are just turning the clock back 50 years to where farmers in their region are growing food that is very probably sold relatively locally. And I guess we're just going back to the common sense ideas of family farming. So we would expect to go on growing Piper's Farm and scaling up what we do, but we wouldn't compromise the essential components of the food we produce.
Do any of your other products subsidise the chicken? That is an extremely good price, isn't it, compared to what we're paying for the other higher quality chickens?
Yeah, I think Poulet de Bresse are marketed with a particular branding. They're almost designer food for chefs.
Yeah.
People, obviously, they can buy a bigger chicken of ours and they can pay 18 or 20 pounds for a bigger chicken and get loads of meals out of it. But we believe that is the right, sort of pricing for a commercial version of growing food for everybody. We're not trying to be elitist.
Sorry to interrupt, but it's a kind of a really important discussion. Does it make you enough profit, or are you actually trying to make a point by selling to
But remember, we are selling directly to the final consumer.
We don't sell to supermarkets.
We don't sell to people who are the tail that wags the dog. When Henry and I started Piper's Farm, we were very clear about two things. One, the quality of what we produced. Secondly, we were going to sell it straight to the people who ate it. That makes a very big difference.
And it means that all the price is in producing the food. Mm-hmm. It's not in producing, you know, somebody else making a margin.
Mm-hmm. And that's what local food culture is about.
Mm-hmm. Or food culture, if it's not in your locality, dealing directly with the farmer, because obviously we're in London.
Yes. But that's the joy of online. I mean, my great-grandfather, if he'd been offered a place in 55 million sitting rooms 24/7, he would have bitten your arm off, because that is dynamite in retailing terms, and that's what we've got. And also, very importantly, we understand that probably 75% of what we do is deliver convenience. That is a massive proportion, I appreciate, but actually in today's culture and society, if you can't make it really simple and convenient for your customers, that's, you're kidding yourself. So we package it so that it's single portions if you've got chicken portions. You go online, it's delivered to your door, you take it out of the freezer when you come home, drop it in water, use it in 10 minutes. All of that has to be part of the understanding of our industry about how to deliver what the marketplace wants. And it shouldn't be the ownership of massive corporations to tell the market what they want. Mm. They should tell us, and we should offer them directly. You take an awful lot of extra cost and stuff people don't want, you just remove it.
Yes, I mean, I wish it would end on that note. To pull things down a few levels, the bog standard chicken costs £4 a bird.
Can I just, at this point, Peter, you're very like Margaret Thatcher, it's almost impossible to interrupt. I'm not really aware, but just from the chef's point of view, and I think this is what's fascinating of the Guild of Food Writers events that I've attended as somebody like yourselves, just there and interested, and then behind the scenes, different things happen, is that it is all about the food, it's all about how it's produced, and actually nobody has said anything about how has it been cooked tonight. Mm. And that's fine.
But could you say?
I'm just about to. Actually, you made me well enough, I'm not going to let a lot get away without briefly about the cooking. But that is what is so fascinating, is that it's so much of what we read about is all about the chefs, and we're talking about that's because the chefs want these fancy birds eating a bit of whatever it is. But the point about it is that actually the better the bird, the more that you, the love, the attention, the care you put into it, the easier it should be and is for the consumer just to cook it. And I think that's really, really exciting. I really enjoy cooking most of these birds tonight. And I'm quite shocked actually at some of the things that have dribbled into the pan afterwards. I'm part of the Sam Hopkinson school of chickens, in that you just lather it with as much butter as you can spend. Normally I would put lemons inside the bird as well, and some thyme and some rosemary, and roast it at a very high temperature for about 50 minutes until it starts to colour, and then turn the temperature right down, and then it'll cook nice and slowly. Now, I think I probably did your bird a slight injustice. I think it should have had maybe that length of time to start off with, but even lower temperature, just a gentle tick over. And then as Hopkinson says, who needs flour and stuff to make a gravy when all you need is to squeeze out the lemons from the inside of the carcass and it all just amalgamates, and you strain it through a sieve and you've got stunning, slightly tangy, wonderful gravy, because the chicken we're all talking about has got such great flavour. And that is it.
And texture.
I feel the chef slightly, I'm conning everybody, because they cook themselves. Not one in a bag and shake it and it carves itself. But the bird just does cook itself, because people like you put so much care and attention into making it. And I have to say, I really enjoyed cooking that bird this evening, and I felt slightly guilty that I probably didn't quite do it the justice
it is.
It's just joy, it's great. I'm just, it's just that how we end up about the guilt, it's just such a pleasure to be. I've learned so much.
Yes, I'm so sorry we have to pull it to a close, but perhaps there'll be a brief chance to touch one another as we go on, but we really mustn't overstay our welcome. I mean, our poor hosts have had to go, unfortunately, and we are very grateful to Senses for hosting us. A very quick thanks for everyone else to go. Thank you to Christopher, of course, and Linda, who's prepared all the salads.